So, what do you know about how the property came into their family?
My understanding from the last owner was that it was obtained by her grandfather. He sold some property in Warrington and bought the farm. And it was all hardwood at that time. Now you're looking at it here. At first it was just a little one-story house. The house was built, according to courthouse records, in 1864.
So then when did they add on the second floor?
Sometime in the early 1900s. And the reason that was done was they brought one son with them, which was the father, and he married, and of course they started a family, and the house was suddenly too small.
Okay. When was she born, do you know?
She was born in 1921, August 13th. She was the second child born to the family. The first child was a baby boy that was born on Christmas Eve in 1917. And he only lived until New Year's Day. So she talked about him extensively early on, but in my time of knowing her, I never heard her speak of him.
And then when did you meet her, and how did you guys meet?
We bought property here in 1971, and we moved up here with the family and established a home on the property we had purchased. And she came up to visit us, which was a common thing that the neighborhood did. When anyone came in, they always wanted to meet and greet. So that was very nice. And at that time, there were very few houses on this road. Mm. It has grown up considerably since 1971. She is still working at Penn Middle School as a librarian. And at that time that I met her, her father had passed away, so I did not get to meet him. I would like to have met him. And I did meet her mother, and I helped her care for her.
Did you talk about her parents a lot, like once they had passed?
Yes, she did. She spoke of, especially her dad, a typical daughter, you know, very enamored with her daddy, as I was with my daddy, and I'm sure you are with your daddy.
Yeah.
It just is part of life. Yeah.
Can you talk about any of that kind of like lifestyle stuff?
Mm-hmm. The family at that time never did any cooking inside the house, the back portion of the house, that was the kitchen in the back, so no cooking was done in the house. And then they always had servants. Even just before she went into the nursing home, she had people coming in to help her do household things and cooking, especially cooking. And then she would have food until they came back again and cooked other foods for her, what she had asked them to prepare. So the upper level was where the servants, when they weren't busy, could go and rest. And of course, one stayed overnight, especially when there were children in the household, to help the mother care for them.
Gotcha. Was she a good cook?
She couldn't boil water, and she would admit it. She never learned to cook, and it was something that just never became her interest. So, as time went along, she ate convenient food. After her mother passed away, she only had someone come in to help her occasionally, like once a week.
Did she do work on the farm at all?
Her father never allowed her to go into the barn lot. The farm was taken over. She came down to the barn lot one day and made a statement that that was the first time she had been down to the barn. But her daddy said ladies don't go in the barns, so he would never allow her to do anything on the farm at all.
Wow. So for like 50 years, she had never seen the barn? Oh my goodness.
Only from the view of the back porch. And if you notice from the back porch of the house, you can see the barn. Her dad would bring the cattle in for various reasons. She was allowed to stand in the back porch and watch.
Mm.
You know, I sometimes wonder if losing the first child, if that made them just a little overprotective of her.
Mm. Probably.
Yeah.
Can you talk about the boxwoods and any kind of like plants, garden, that kind of stuff?
Mm-hmm. They had a huge garden in the back of the house that probably covered a quarter of an acre. And they had people, you know, people that worked for them that did all the gardening. And Mr. had a team of mule that he did all the farm work with. So I'm sure he plowed the garden with them.
Mm-hmm.
And made all the hay with his team of mules. He never owned a tractor because they said it was too dangerous, so they wouldn't allow him to purchase a tractor. Poor guy. And the garden was planted, and then workers took care of it. I never found any record that they were actually slave owners, but they always had help. And a lot of times they would give them food from the garden rather than actual cash money, because everybody had families back then,
mm-hmm.
and usually large families as well. And the house, the plants around the house, the mother planted two arborvitae trees. They were very unique to the area. And then the boxwoods, when she married, bought the cuttings from her original home and planted them in various places around the house. And they grew and grew. And they kind of got out of hand after a while.
You're doing great. You had said before there was an ice pond that was close to the house.
The ice pond, she still owned that at the time of her death. And the dam has been removed at this point, so it's just a creek with a pool. It was approximately 10 foot deep. And in the wintertime, they would take a team of horses out and cut the ice into large blocks, load it onto the wagon, and bring it back. And in the cellar, there are concrete shelves around the north wall of the cellar, and they would place the ice in there, and that's how they preserve some of the foods. And they would go back all winter long and stockpile ice to try to get into the summer.
So the ice pond was separate from the farm property, right?
Yes, it's probably about 3/4 of a mile away.
Oh, and then the scratches on the door?
She had a friend, and he had given her a collie. And the dog's name was Yankee, because he was from the north. So she named the dog after his heritage. Yankee somehow became very, very frightened in thunderstorms and lightning storms. So when a storm would come up, she would take the dog into the closet, and there's no windows in it, and not have a light on. She would take a flashlight for her well-being. And the dog just panicked and would just scratch and claw the door in just total panic. And he was like that until he passed away. And at that time, she wasn't aware of sedatives, and I'm not even sure they had developed them. She was totally enamored with collies and never had anything but a registered collie that looked as much like Lassie as she could find one. And she had five different collies. The last one died just a year before she went into the nursing home, and I was with her when it passed away. And all the gravestones are still in the front yard. I never got around, and she never did either, putting the last one there.
Oh.
So there should be one additional one.
Gotcha.
But at this point, it's kind of a unnecessary expense.
And I was digging through this barrel of stuff the other day. I saw there was a dog collar that had nails sticking out of it.
Oh.
I'm assuming they did that for coyotes, right? Maybe her dad had some working dogs or something.
I know they had hunting dogs. Her dad always had hunting dogs. Yeah.
Yeah, my dad was saying too that you thought that there was a fox den in the barn.
Yes. A red fox.
Oh man. I have seen holes, but I thought they were groundhog holes.
There is a big old groundhog hole, and there's two big groundhog holes in the barn.
Yeah, and then there's a bunch in that the back wing.
That's where the fox den was too.
Oh,
not that there wasn't also groundhog.
Yeah.
Downstairs.